Good evening and welcome to the third Malta Sustainability Forum for 2023. I'm Daniel Gravino, your host for this evening, where we'll be discussing the need for affordable housing solutions. Contributing to the event are a number of distinguished speakers with whom you'll have the opportunity to interact via a dedicated Q&A session. There is a Q&A function at the bottom of the screen that you can use whenever you'd like. Without further ado, I would like to introduce Mr. Marcel Kassar, who is the CEO of APS Bank, to deliver his welcome address.
Good evening. My turn to welcome you to this last event of the Malta Sustainability Forum for 2023. When we launched the forum in 2019, I recall that it was received as something innovative, almost like ahead of its time, as talk about sustainability then was few and far between. And when in an interview, I had emphasized that the notion of sustainability should go beyond climate and the environment, I recall being asked what this meant. If sustainability was then still an abstract concept for many, COVID-19 made sure that it didn't remain. As the world responded to the devastating impacts of the virus, countries faced a reality check, reallocated resources to deal with its consequences, and reset their priorities. More reality checks were to follow. Outbreaks of war in different parts of the world, rampant inflation and scarcity of key commodities, natural and weather disasters. I would say that all this has helped propagate a better understanding that sustainability is ultimately about providing for ourselves, but also about protecting ourselves. It's about meeting the needs of the present without compromising those of the future. Ever since we launched the forum, we were always concerned with the question, what way of life are we leaving for the future generations? And one of our overarching aims was to create awareness of the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, or the SDGs as they're known. 17 goals adopted in 2015 that are meant to provide nations with an international framework for more equitable, peaceful, resilient, and prosperous societies by 2030. When we look around us and see how Maltese society has been progressing over the years, we need to keep in mind a number of these goals that speak of no poverty, good health, well-being and sanitation, affordable energy, good infrastructure, and importantly, sustainable cities and communities. Which brings me to the theme for today's event, affordable housing solutions. Adequate housing is a basic human need and part and parcel of the right for an adequate standard of living for all. Access to adequate and affordable housing is crucial to promote socially and economically diverse communities in which residents have access to quality facilities, services, amenities, and also employment opportunities. Inadequate housing can impact negatively on urban equity and inclusivity, on urban safety and livelihood opportunities, and also cause negative health conditions. The right to adequate housing is recognized in many international conventions and instruments, key among them the Universal Declaration on Human Rights. In fact, one of the SDGs specifically refers to a target 11.1, which is, and here I quote, to ensure access for all to adequate, safe, and affordable housing and basic services, and the upgrading of slums by 2030. Now, slums in Malta are a thing of history, but progress brings about other problems like overdevelopment, heavy urbanization, waste management, pollution, and traffic, just to mention a few. And one particular pressure point is housing affordability. As bankers, we are at the heart of business decisions that impact social and economic change, while making sure that these do not come at a cost to our general well-being. Ensuring the availability of affordable housing stock is a key sustainability challenge that requires the cooperation of many players with government. And I am pleased to say that APS Bank has been leading the way in promoting awareness about these challenges, collaborating especially with the Ministry for Social and Affordable Accommodation in the creation of schemes and solutions to address the need for more affordable housing. At this point, I leave you. I thank you as our esteemed audience and wish you all a very successful event.
Thank you, Mr. Kassar, for providing a very clear picture of the context within which this event will be taking place. And I now welcome Honourable Minister Rodrigo Galdes, who is the Minister for Affordable and Social Accommodation, who will be delivering his keynote address.
Thank you very much. Today I want to talk to you about something that affects our youth, our disadvantaged groups, thousands of middle-aged individuals and the vast majority of our elderly population. A phenomenon that touches the very core of our communities, affordable housing. It's a topic that's close to my heart since, like many of you following, I'm a parent. I listen to the perspective of a teenager and a young adult every day. So I am aware of the challenges they face in the sector, and I believe that the future of these generations should be a priority to all of us. Let's start by acknowledging the obvious. Finding a place to call home is a basic human need, a fundamental right. It's not a luxury. But unfortunately, in today's world, it often feels like one. The rising cost of housing is not only a local issue and has become a pressing issue in many parts of the world, and it's affecting people from all walks of life. So what is affordable housing? The words affordable housing cannot be interchangeable with the idea of cheap housing. On the contrary, it's about housing that is decent, safe, and within the financial reach for people of all income levels. It's about creating communities where everyone can afford to live comfortably and sustainably without sacrificing their basic needs and quality of life. But how do we achieve affordable housing? Well, there's no one-size-fits-all solution, but there are some steps we can take. First and foremost, we need policies and regulations that encourage affordable housing development. The government, together with the housing authority, has in recent years, through continuous dialogue with people and policymakers, introduced schemes that have at their heart the creation of new affordable housing pathways. I mentioned the schemes such as the 10-year, 10,000 grant for the first-time buyers, the equity sharing scheme, and the deposit payment scheme, among others. Thousands have benefited from these important schemes. A year ago, we made another step in the right direction. Together with the Archdiocese of Malta, we set up the Foundation for Affordable Housing. At present, we are all jointly exploring ways and possibilities of further achieving our main objective of affordable and sustainable housing. Joint work is a very important ingredient in our process of succeeding in our mission. Affordable housing isn't just a matter of economics. It's about social equity and inclusivity. It's about ensuring that our cities and neighborhoods are diverse and vibrant, where people from different backgrounds can live side by side, learn from one another, and build stronger, more connected communities. Affordable housing isn't just about the physical structures. It's also about the people who live in them. We will continue strengthening our existing schemes to assist low-income families with down payments and rent subsidies. Our mission is to assist people climb the property ladder as well as sustain others who enter the property sector upon their own remit. In conclusion, affordable housing is not just a dream. It's a necessity. It's about providing people with the stability and security they need to thrive. It's about creating communities that are inclusive, diverse, and vibrant. Let's work together to make affordable housing a reality for all. Because when everyone has a safe and affordable place to call home, our entire society benefits, not only today, but for the foreseeable future. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister, for your contribution to this forum. Now I welcome Dr. Brian Mikalev, who will be sharing with us some data-driven insights on housing affordability in Malta. Brian is the executive head of policy at the Housing Authority.
Good afternoon. Housing occupies a central part of our lives. Its quality directly influences our health and well-being, and its costs absorb a large share of household income. So in today's presentation, I will focus on housing affordability in Malta by looking at the evidence from different data sources. Let's start with the big picture. The chart shows the 10-year status of households in Malta over the last decade or so. This is survey data from the EU Silk, which is an annual survey harmonized across all EU countries on income, housing, and living conditions. And there are three important issues that immediately stand out. Number one, around 80% of households in Malta are homeowners. So contrary to the situation in other European countries, the share has remained remarkably stable over time. The second important point that we note is that most of these homeowners do not even have an outstanding mortgage or a home loan. That said, the share of homeowners with a mortgage, which tend to be relatively young, has been gradually increasing over time. And the third important point is that we notice a sharp increase in the share of tenants paying rents at market prices. Here we have to keep in mind the influx of foreign workers, most of whom rely on the private rental market for their accommodation, even though I have to say that foreign workers are not well captured within official surveys. At the same time, the share of tenants paying rents at reduced prices has halved. So given this macro picture, the question that we should ask ourselves is, for whom is housing not affordable? It is already clear at this point that any metric that we use to gauge affordability should focus on the distribution of outcomes across households rather than relying on economy-wide averages. So, who faces the highest affordability challenges? This chart also uses data from the Silk survey, and it shows the share of housing costs in disposable income in 2021. On the vertical axis, we find two broad groups. The top group refers to families with no dependents, and the bottom group refers to families with dependent children. And the red line indicates the 25% ratio, which is commonly considered as the affordability threshold. That is, households that pay more than 25% of their income on housing may remain with insufficient funds to cover their basic necessities, especially if they are on low income. The chart clearly identifies three categories whose housing costs are more than 25% of their disposable income. The first category refers to single persons younger than 65 years of age on low income. These can include first-time buyers or even individuals that go through a relationship breakdown later in life. The second category refers to single persons with dependent children on low income. And the third category refers to large families on low income. In this case, large families is defined as two adults with three or more dependent children. So in general, these are the type of families that policies aimed at improving affordability should target. Let me focus now a bit on the first-time buyers, because they are one of the categories more prone to face affordability difficulties. Today, it is a reality that house purchases by first-time buyers are financed by a home loan. And the concept of purchase affordability is closely related to the minimum income requirement for a borrower to be eligible for a mortgage. So the chart shows the minimum income required for three different values of property prices, 175,000, 200,000, and 225,000, that are generally within the range considered by first-time buyers, and different debt-to-service income ratios. The debt-to-service income refers to the amount of debt service payments relative to income. So in this case, for example, a DSTI of 25% means that monthly mortgage payments absorb 25% of the borrower's income. So it is already very clear with this chart that even with quite plausible assumptions, the range of minimum income required is quite broad, ranging from around 22,000 to more than 36,000, 37,000. The key assumptions here that we also have to take into consideration are the interest rate. Interest rates typically depend on macro forces, such as the monetary policy set by the central bank, but also bank-specific factors, such as credit and liquidity risks. The loan-to-value ratio for first-time buyers, typically this would be around 90%, which would mean that first-time buyers would have to save 10% of the value of the property, and also very important is the years to repayment. It makes a difference whether borrowers have 20, 30, or 40 years left to pay the mortgage. Now, the key messages from this chart are two. First of all, when considering affordability, especially for first-time buyers, we also have to take into consideration not only income and property prices, but also the financing conditions. And the second important message is the importance of savings for young individuals that is necessary to accumulate the necessary resources to be eligible for a home loan. And today also, for the first time, we have good quality information on first-time buyers. I will just mention two statistics. The first one is that slightly more than half of the first-time buyers in 2022 purchased a property on their own. This seems to be in direct contradiction to studies that show that unless there are two wage earners, housing is no longer affordable to single borrowers. The second point, which I'm showing here in the chart, is that the value of properties purchased by single and co-borrowers tend to differ a bit. For instance, the most common range for first-time buyers that purchase the property by themselves tend to be between 150,000 and 250,000, whereas for co-borrowers, the value of the properties tend to be a little bit higher, with the most common range being between 200,000 and 300,000. Finally, any discussion about affordability wouldn't be complete if we don't say anything about the rent assistance for low-income families to help them cope with their monthly rent payments. If we look at the HBS, the Housing Benefit Scheme of the Housing Authority, we find that there are around 3,000 households receiving rent assistance. Around two of these three are Maltese households, with the remaining one-third being broadly split between EU nationals and another category that include refugees, those benefiting from subsidiary protection, and long-term residents, The chart shows how much beneficiaries pay before the assistance and how much they are actually paying after they receive the rent assistance. So, whereas prior to the assistance, most rents would be in excess of 550 euro per month, with the assistance, around a third of them end up paying less than 250 euro per month. Overall, a measure like the HBS is intended to provide some relief from rental payments to low-income households, without which many of them would struggle to make ends meet. Let me now conclude. And I want to leave you with these 4 points as food for thought. When we talk about unaffordable housing, we should ask ourselves, unaffordable for whom? And this is very important since, as I shown before, 80% of Maltese households are homeowners. A lot of them don't even have a mortgage, and a substantial number of them even own a second property. So here we should always focus on the distribution rather than economy-wide averages. The second important point is that for low-income households, even paying 25% of their income on housing might leave them with insufficient resources to cover their most basic needs. Let me just give you one example. A household earning 10,000 per month and spends 50% of its income on housing costs will still have 5,000 euros left, which would be more than enough to make ends meet quite easily. On the contrary, a household earning just 800 euros, paying just 25% on housing, will leave only 600 euros to cover the basic necessities, which most probably will not be enough. The third point would be the importance of evidence-based decision-making. Today, we have more and better data. I showed some statistics on first-time buyers, but you also have more granular statistics, for instance, on the rent register that was not available until 2020. This data is being used to make more informed decisions. And finally, it is very important that when we talk about an affordability, we should also take into consideration the policy measures taken to alleviate this challenge. Thank you for your attention.
Ryan, for that very clear picture of the current situation in Malta. And thank you also for providing us with those four very important points, which we really need to put a lot of effort into thinking about. Next, we have a presentation on the European perspective of affordable housing. This will be given by Ms. Saoirse Edwards, who is the General Secretary of Housing Europe.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much for the invitation. I'm honored to be joining you, at least online, at the Malta Sustainability Forum. Sorry not to be there in person, of course, it's always better, but at least technology allows us to share information in this way. So what I would like to do is just give you a little taste of what the type of conversations around housing are at the moment at EU level. Of course, I'm coming from the perspective of Housing Europe, which represents the different public, social and cooperative housing providers all over Europe. So what we are doing is checking what are the European institutions saying, but also what are the members on the ground saying, what are cities reporting back, and what type of data are we seeing to reflect the reality of what the housing reality on the ground in Europe. So I think as many of you may be aware, the ongoing challenge for many Europeans to find affordable homes is becoming more and more acute in many cities and towns around Europe. But what I think is relatively good news is that this this real phenomena is at last having a resonance at European level. So we are hearing at European level the worries and concerns of European citizens reflected within the European Parliament and within the Committee of the Regions, within the Economic and Social Committee, and even in the Council. So we saw for the first time in recent years a generalized debate in the plenary of the European Parliament just last week. And there we saw MEPs from across the political spectrum. I've just picked a few there. So Kim von Sparentek from the Green Party and your own Alexa Saliba from Malta, from the SD group. So what this is a reflection of is that there's an increased recognition that if we want a successful European project, one which includes young people, includes elderly people, optimizes education, we're going to need affordable housing for those people. So we saw also a reflection from Kim von Sparentek that while this is not a European competence, there is increasing recognition that there are some EU policies which could be adapted to allow member states to deal with this challenge in a more efficient way. And interesting, there you see in the middle of the screen that I'm showing is that we also heard from Nicholas Schmidt. So that's from the European Commission and the commissioner responsible for employment and social affairs. And he, strong statement saying this is affecting everyone, prevents young people from leaving their family homes, forcing them to delay major decisions in their lives. The right to decent housing and affordable housing is at the heart of social Europe. So this is quite a new development and we see it as positive. But of course, this is coming about because the scale of the problem at local level is growing. And let's just look a little bit at the rest of the European Union and where housing is placed in European debates. So we have to think of the fact that when Ursula von der Leyen came into the position of European Commission President 5 years ago, she most probably expected that her main challenge would be the Green Deal, so the greening of the continent by 2050, and our positioning vis-a-vis the rest of the world, so China and the US. However, her plans and her expectations, and all of our expectations, of course, were really shook up by the COVID pandemic and the Ukraine invasion. So what is the reason I mention these two phenomena? So both of these phenomena, external phenomena, have a very large housing dimension. So when we think of the COVID pandemic, suddenly we had a call for all to stay at home. And at that point, there was a realization that many people did not have a home to go to, and many people did not have an adequate home to go to. So immediately we saw radical and fast solutions being brought into play, with short-term temporary accommodation being provided to reduce homeless numbers, for instance. And then, of course, if we look to the Ukraine invasion, we see a very large influx of people from the affected territory not being able to find appropriate accommodation in EU member states. So these two factors have also contributed to showing a light on the lack of affordable housing that we have, the lack of the capacity of our sector currently to deal with crisis and to absorb shocks. And to, of course, if we think about the bigger goals of inclusion in the long term, we see this is definitely a challenge with young people, elderly people. But these two urgent phenomena showed just the lack of capacity even for our cities, of our member states, to deal with those housing related shocks. And what does that translate into? So there are a number of initiatives as well that have a clear housing dimension at European level. So if we look at the energy, for instance, we see that we are on an ongoing situation of homes that are not built to provide affordable heating and cooling for our European citizens. So there's insufficient quality of the dwellings on European territory. And linked to this and linked to the Green Deal, of course, we see the Renovation Wave, an initiative with direct impact on the quality of homes for people, but of course, requiring massive investment. And then if you look in the middle of the slide there, and this is another European level initiative which has a direct impact on housing. So it is the European Pillar of Social Rights. And the Principle 19 in that pillar actually commits member states who have signed up to providing housing for those in need, and for also a commitment to work to end homelessness by 2030. So this, I must stress, is soft law. It's a European commitment, however, with no binding legislation. However, it does show that member states have signed up to this voluntary commitment to end homelessness by 2030. Again, a reflection of the growing scale of the issue at local level. We can also mention the new European Bauhaus, so initiative also coming from European from the European Commission, from the highest level, from the office of the president herself. And this is a recognition of the fact that, yes, we need to build, we need to renovate. However, we should look at building aesthetically pleasing developments. We should work on the sustainability of those developments and the inclusivity of those developments. So these are high-level initiatives coming from the European level, which indeed impact the how member states are looking at the housing issues, and of course how our members in Housing Europe are looking at housing issues. So just a reminder, when we say we're coming from the perspective of Housing Europe, who indeed are we working with on a daily basis? So we're working with all of the entities in the EU which are working to provide public, social, and cooperative housing. And we were very happy to welcome very recently Malta to the Housing Europe network. So overall, that's a very diverse group of public, social, and cooperative housing providers, roughly delivering 200,000 new dwellings per year and refurbishing an equivalent amount, with a significant investment of 40 billion annually in the sector. What we are working towards, the overall goal is, of course, to provide decent, affordable housing for all. So again, we are happy at European level that we see this increased recognition. We see that Nicholas Schmidt, also the commissioner responsible for jobs and social rights, recognizing that, yes, this is a local problem. However, because we are seeing this local problem all over the European territory, what he has stated is this is a European problem, although the solutions may very well be national and local. However, he does see a role for the EU to bring together member states to have increased exchange, not only on ending homelessness, but also the challenge of providing affordable homes, because of course the challenge of homelessness is just the tip of the iceberg. It's the most visible form of housing exclusion or failure of housing policies, whereas actually the lack of affordability is the ticking time bomb behind the doors that may be not visible when we walk around our towns and cities. So what we do see is that there's increased appetite between member states, between governments to share. And we saw for the first time in 13 years under the French presidency of the European Union, we saw a meeting of the ministers responsible for housing, a so-called informal housing ministers meeting, coming together. So this, after a gap of 13 years, finally coming together and recognizing, yes, there's a European dimension here, but there's also big potential to access European finance, but also exchange with each other. So this is why I was used this slide and this quote from Commissioner Schmidt, recognizing, of course, the local dimension, the fact that it's a local competence and it's a question of subsidiarity, but also that the EU has a role to play. I think we have to work to define that role before the European elections and the next commission comes in. So just to remind, so what we have to look at when we're looking at housing policy, and this for Housing Europe, this is really goes to the core of what we try to achieve, this balance between availability, affordability, sustainability. Very often there's a push from the legislative side, a very strong push on sustainability. What we need to have that balance is how can we achieve sustainability and without compromising nature, biodiversity, but deliver affordable homes that are available in the right place where people need them. But what are we seeing at the moment? Unfortunately, the crisis looks that is affecting many European citizens looks set to worsen. And why is that? So we have increase in construction prices being reported back by the public social and cooperative housing providers. This began in COVID, but increased after the invasion of Ukraine. We also see on this slide, if you look on the chart on the left, what is something we are all aware of, increasing high inflation. So this is driving up cost of living for citizens, but it's also affecting, so not only direct fuel prices, but also food. So what we are hearing reports back from many of the residents in the homes being managed by our members is that actually the challenge of making ends meet, just purchasing food, is becoming a real challenge, which is a very worrying message we're getting back from the ground. So this cost of living crisis is really biting those who potentially live in homes that are not efficient, who potentially use a car, potentially have many mouths to feed. So the a real cost of living crisis is impacting those who were really were already weakened by the situation. So this is one of the statistics that we have gathered under the umbrella of our State of Housing Report 2023. So this is a report you're very welcome to visit. So I put the address of the publication there on the screen, stateofhousing.eu. So that is the result of the work of my colleague Alice Pettini, reaching out to social housing providers, public housing providers across the territory to hear, okay, what problems are you facing? What is the housing situation near you? And just, as I say, feel free to access that publication, but I just picked out a few of those points that were reported back. So from the public, corporate and social housing side, they're committed to the fair energy transition. And we see actually even social housing providers actually ahead of private housing stock in France, for instance, with 46% of social housing in France already renovated to A, B or C level, so A, B or C energy label, whereas only 25% of the total housing stock. We see in Austria the limited profit housing providers that make up our membership also very committed to this space. And Estonia, a country with many privately owned homes organized in housing cooperatives, we see also progress more rapidly than in the individual homes, which are not part of an organized homeowner cooperative. So what we see is that overall the performance is good. However, these projects are slowing down because of the current situation. So what we are seeing is unsustainable. If you see in this slide now, so if we have to increase efforts now in these uncertain times, and we see that the ongoing work to reduce the CO2 footprint of housing in Europe is still an ongoing challenge, but we have to put that in the context of this weakened society and higher prices. So we see that the current context, because of unsustainable costs for construction and renovation, is contributed to now by the cost of finance. So we see in France, for example, just to renovate their target they have set 2034 of 1.8 million dwellings, the cost of that has gone from 5 billion up to at least 7.5 billion. So the cost of capital is being added into the mix. And this is something, of course, relevant for many of you in the room today working in the banking sector. So as you can see, all of these trends coming together is really slowing down construction, slowing down renovation. And while we do see some signs of recovery in countries like Austria, for instance, it's a generalized slowdown. And this, coupled obviously with the increase in mortgage rates that now we see through Eurostat, so a huge drop off in the number of people applying for mortgages and the number of people being able to afford mortgages, what we are going to see is an even increased demand for rent. So we're going to see an upward surge in rent prices, higher demand for rent, less people being able to access ownership. So a little bit of a perfect storm coming in the housing sector, where we're going to see more demand for the state to step in and come up with solutions to see how can they address the needs of mid and low income groups in society. So indeed, on this slide, you can see this risk of backlogs in the sector as a result of all of these price increase. So obviously here in this slide, you can see the results of when all of this impact trickles down, not to the people on the waiting list, so the waiting lists are growing, but it's trickling down also to people living in rental accommodation. So an increase in rent arrears, you can see in France, of 10%. In Denmark, more warnings of people, so economic evictions, and more people living in energy poverty. So in the Netherlands, 90,000 from 2022. And what it boils down to is just more people with more difficulty in making ends meet in Europe. Obviously, we see a mobilization from the sector to help households, help support neighborhoods to go through this difficult patch. However, I think this is why your conference today and the move that we see at European level, increased realization that really it's time for public authorities to sit together and say, okay, what solutions can we really come up with at this point? Are there some creative ideas that we can think of to address what is really a generalized problem throughout Europe? And I think this conference you're holding today is being held at a very crucial time. So we are obviously looking in, if you see on this slide, we're looking into a strategic moment in Europe. So coming up, the European elections in June. Obviously, we will see a big shift within the European Parliament. And we hope this won't be a shift that many people fear. So a shift to more, let's say, conservative policies, which will be less inclined to invest in people and invest particularly in policies that ensure that no people are left behind in our society. So we're hoping that what we are seeing in some member states to a shift to a more conservative policy is not going to worsen the situation. We are hoping that the next commission will continue to take this issue seriously and will take the good ideas that I hope that come from your session today and that come from discussions here in Europe, some good concrete solutions that I hope the next European Commission can take forward to support member states in what many of them are trying to do, and that is really meet their citizens need for what is really a basic need if we want to fulfill our potential in our lives, and that is a roof over our head, a decent home. So thank you very much. I leave you there. Again, very sorry not to be there in person with you in Malta. I know some of my colleagues were there just recently for another high-level prestigious event. So I hope we can meet in person soon, and let's work together on coming up with clever, innovative solutions and good policy choices so that indeed people can meet their potential in their lives by having this basic need and a place to call home. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Edwards, for providing the international context within which this discussion is taking place. We now move on to the panel discussion, where we'll be dealing with the current affordable housing solutions and whether these are sustainable when we look into the future. We have with us four panelists. We have Dr. Jake Atsopardi, who is the CEO of the Foundation for Affordable Housing, Mr. Miguel Calleja, who is a product portfolio manager at APS Bank. We have with us also Dr. Rachel Shikluna, who is joining us on a video call from Australia. She is the lead researcher and consultant of SOS Malta and also the chairperson of the Guardian of Future Generations. Finally, we have with us Mr. Wetu Zerafa, who is the CEO of the Housing Authority. May I remind those of you who are following us online that you can submit your questions using the Q&A function, which is at the bottom of the screens. Well, based on earlier presentations and also on what we know from our respective lines of expertise, I think we can say that the situation, the housing situation in Malta, is not perhaps as bad as in some other European countries, but we do have our challenges. And primary amongst those fighting these challenges is the Housing Authority. So I'll start with you, Matthew. Can you tell us what the Housing Authority is currently doing to alleviate the problem of affordable housing, and perhaps more importantly, the extent to which we are being successful?
First of all, thank you for the invitation, and thank you, Daniel, for the question. We, as Housing Authority, we take pride in our mission statement, and I would like to kickstart the discussion primarily by highlighting the importance that we give primarily to the stability. Stability primarily of families within households and communities, and willing stability with the sustainability of the economy and sustainability of society. So primarily we're linking sustainability and stability. If we put stability at the heart of our policy making decisions, then we are on the right track. So, and that is what the general public expects of an authority that is required to provide adequate and affordable housing provision. So to wrap up the initial remarks, we're managing a balancing act, okay? So, as previously Brian explained in his presentation, we evaluate the profiles of people requesting accommodation and housing provision, primarily by age and income. And through this approach, we can measure what is required to ensure that the market remains sustainable, and if the market is facing some difficulties or changes and pressures, we have to intervene to ensure stability. So that is the balancing act we're trying to achieve here. And it remains part, we take pride in this. And to explain further, I would like also to share with you a story of a friend of mine, which happens to be when he was young, he faced illness, cancer, and following 5 years of battling this illness, which each and any one of us can encounter at any point in life. He managed to win over the battle. But given what the market requires for him to buy a property and move on in life, so following a 5-year, 6-year battle, he achieved cancer remission, but he couldn't access the market, not due to his income. Right. He could sustain a bank loan, but he couldn't be provided with life insurance. And as we all know, in Malta, it is required, it is a requirement by banks that a life insurance, a life policy is gained by the applicant to in order to. And when we've listened to this story, as a ministry and as a sector, there were no products available for these kind of situations. So imagine you're fighting against a very important phase in your life, and then you're faced with this difficulty. And we've devised a product primarily for these kind of situations, the New Hope Scheme. The New Hope Scheme is a scheme that guarantees, it's like a, it makes up for what is required by banks, and we guarantee as a government, as a housing authority, we guarantee that portion, that value of the loan that will be drawn down. And nowadays we have a product that substitutes this gap that was presenting itself as a problem. And we take pride in evaluating different profiles and life events of different situations. For example, we're not here speaking of just social cases, but we evaluated, for example, persons that experience marital breakdowns at later age. And we have products devised particularly for that. Students or people at young age that haven't yet gathered enough to sustain the 10% required by banks to buy a property. So they can sustain a bank loan throughout their 40-year term, but they cannot gather enough money to kickstart that process. And we have devised particular products for those kind of people. So we take pride in evaluating age and income and trying to close in the gaps on what the market is not providing to ensure that it's sustainable and yet providing stability.
So if I understand you well, it's not just the case that the housing authority is catering sort of for the general first-time buyer, but you're actually looking at these very specific cases. Exactly. Because I believe, as Brian mentioned earlier in his presentation here, it's a question of the who those individuals are and their specific circumstances. One of the questions we got from our audience is, you know, has to do very much with the prices that are being paid out there for, you know, for selling, I don't know, your average apartment. And they're actually asking, you know, is it really true that we can find apartments selling for anything between 175K to 125K? Is that the case from the data that you see?
From the data, what we see is that even single applicants are buying properties. It's like it's somewhere close to 75% of the first-time buyers market, okay? Single applicants, so single buyers, single household buyers, are affording properties within that particular bracket.
Right.
Obviously, there is a trade-off that is happening, so one has to manage. If you're trying to buy a property within a specific locality, you might have to do some trade-offs and to afford a particular property in various areas. But if it's a question of affordability in the housing sector in Malta, then I tend to disagree that we have opportunities, and we've been seeing it through current data, as Brian explained. And even through our discussion with banks, we're seeing that people are buying, even single household families are buying properties within that particular bracket that you mentioned.
So,
but we monitor closely, as Brian explained once again, our data real time, and we are able, so we are able to adjust any of our products to make sure that they are being catered for those particular households.
So it's probably a question of looking for those lower price properties in the right places, I guess, because the numbers do suggest that.
Or even the type of property.
Or even the type of adjusting one's expectations, perhaps. A very difficult sort of adjustment to make, perhaps,
it's
for some people,
it's
but yes. One of the challenges. I'll move on to another question, actually, from our audience. And some people are wondering, are asking if, you know, we've got a very strong private market that seems to be functioning well, but they're also wondering whether this can be accompanied by what one could call a social market. And that, I think, fits in very nicely with what you are trying to do, Jake, at the Foundation for Affordable Housing. It's a relatively new entity. So please do tell us a little bit what it's all about. And because from what I've learned, you know, a lot of the objectives that the Foundation has are probably shared with the Housing Authority. I'd really like to hear, you know, what's different. What do you guys bring to the table?
Thank you, Daniel, and thank you to the organizers. Our organization is actually a few months old, so it is one very important for us to introduce ourselves to the public and to those following, and we are very delighted that it had to be this very prestigious annual event where we get the chance to do so. The foundation stems from a shared belief, Daniel. The belief that everyone should afford a decent home, whether they want to buy or they want to rent. Now, in a free market economy, the market should ensure that basic need to everyone. But what is a free market? A free market is free insofar as it allows everyone the freedom to choose between decent alternatives. But if it's not doing that, I believe, and more importantly, the founders believed, that the days where you regulate the market to the point of siphoning all the life and liberty out of it are behind us. And so the foundation is an attempt at participating directly, equally, and fairly in the market. So we are essentially a social enterprise. As a social enterprise, we try to attain social aims, in this case, to supply the market with affordable, adequate accommodation through commercial means. But if you want to flip it over, you can consider us a commercial entity trying to fulfill a social function, which is to help the market give access to everyone.
So basically,
okay? Work for everyone.
The market.
Precisely. As a social enterprise, we try to ensure a surplus across all our activity, but not necessarily the highest attainable profit. So the founders came together. They both hold equal shares in the foundation, the government of Malta and the Church of Malta, so as to ensure that this organization can operate freely and autonomously on the open market. For those familiar with third sector housing in Europe, this is based on Austrian, Dutch, and British housing associations, of course, rooted in Maltese reality. This third sector nature of ours fights or challenges, rather, the old dichotomy which characterized the local property market for years on end, where on the one hand you had the state providing social accommodation for those mostly in need, and on the other you have the private sector supplying the market with residential units for the highest attainable price. We enter somewhere in between the public and the private in order to cater to provide affordable solutions to the in-between class or the stretched class, as we call them, those people who are not welfare dependent, they are in work, mm-hmm. but they're not earning enough in order to be able to buy or rent unaided on the market. So we know that the Housing Authority is very active on the demand side through its various schemes. We hope that by being very active on the supply front now through affordable accommodation and different financing terms, we'll be able to complement that exercise and that work, which is leaving important results. We'll also be publishing a rich material and information regarding the affordability issues existing in Malta. However, our main focus remains to be very active on the supply front.
Right, so basically, if I understand you well, you are the players who now not come in between, but you're sort of halfway between what the private market is providing and what the state is providing. And then you have that group of people who are not dependent on the state for their income. But then they might still be struggling to actually purchase a property or rent a property, for that matter, on the private market.
Yes. Do
you have sort of specific targets in terms of, you know, these groups that you're looking at, or, you know?
I think, first of all, we need to get the issue straight. We need to understand what the issues in the local property market are, in order for us to be able to explain what our targets would be. I think in the categories of people under our remit, which is the in-between class, the stretched class, are where the issues are mostly concentrated.
Right.
Now, we are largely a homeowner's market in Malta, so it is only natural that first-time buyers, the plight of first-time buyers is given a lot of importance and priority. And there's no surprise over there, because using figures from late 2022 or early 2023, today you need 25,000 euros in gross annual income in order to be able to buy the averagely priced apartment on the market.
Right.
And this only if you are under 40. If you are over 40, you need at least 35,000 euros in gross annual income. But not everyone is a first-time buyer. There are people who bought their property some years ago. There are people who chose their tenure and who aren't planning on buying their property, but who are also facing affordability challenges in Malta. Affordability challenges are generally measured as a percentage of the household income spent on housing costs. We normally consider a household that is doing well or adequately if it is not spending over 25 to 30% of its household income on housing costs.
I'm guessing the idea is that, you know, after you spend money on housing, you're left with enough to actually satisfy your other needs.
Now, in Malta, we have 10,000 households right now who are spending 40% of their household income or more on housing costs. Much of these are single-parent households, very significantly. Others are single households. And there are some issues present in the rental market, specifically among the young and foreigners. Now, this will be very well explained in a publication we shall issue, the first publication, actually, of the foundation, which shall be available to the public in the days to come. Now, what are the reasons leading us here? And the main reason, perhaps, is that now, for a prolonged period, we've experienced a steeper increase in property prices than median incomes. Secondly, it is clear that we have strong demand generated and activity in the local property market. However, we ought to understand who is buying what and at what price. Because in the absence of very good, viable alternatives for investment to the property market,
right,
it is very likely the case that we have a lot of second and third time buyers buying in the same housing stock, in the same blocks, which would otherwise be available for the first time buyers. And in so doing, pricing out first time buyers from their own market.
That strikes me as a major concern. So, of course, the first-time buyers are nowadays trying to purchase the very same properties that other people are actually buying as their second or third home or investment, so to say, which then they're renting out at very high rental prices.
Thirdly, and I will conclude on this question, it might very well be a question of supply. Now, we know there is a lot of supply, but it might be a question of quality rather than quantity, in that even though we might have sufficient supply or there is a good number of units coming onto the market regularly, we might have a mismatch in the supply and the demand, in that Malta changed, the people of Malta changed, our family typologies changed,
right,
the housing needs changed, but the supply the private market provides remained very much that which it used to provide in the late 90s and the early 2000s, unfortunately. And that might be creating certain affordability challenges among the cohorts under our remit.
That strikes me as probably a very true point, a point I'd like to pick on even a little later on in our discussion. But Miguel, you and your team obviously meet people who would like to purchase homes almost on a daily basis, I would imagine. Is the bank's experience aligned with what Matthew and Jake have been telling us about what's out there? And also, I know that the bank is in some ways involved in trying to, you know, mitigate this housing affordability problem. Can you see any improvements that we can make in those areas?
Thank you. Thank you, Daniel, for the question. And thank you to the MSF for the invitation to be here today. That's a very interesting question. So I think the first important thing to understand, taking a bit of a macro perspective, is the situation, as Jake and Matthew referenced, that customers today in the market who are seeking to buy the first property are finding themselves in. And I think there are two elements to this. The first element is from a banking perspective. So speaking in general terms around the industry as it is today, for the Maltese market. We are in a bit of a unique situation when compared to our peers, both in other European markets and also elsewhere around the world. So thinking back to, let's say, the last 10 years, with the exception of the last year and a half, Europe and the rest of the world have found themselves in a very unique situation where monetary policy led to a negative or near negative interest rate environment. Right. And the end result of that is that banking interest rates on mortgages, which is the main segments that we serve here in Malta as retail banks, were at very low levels, historically low levels. Now, when you consider the last year and the monetary policy shifts, as Brian referred to earlier, that we've seen, other European markets and other markets around the world have adapted differently than we have. Maltese borrowers, future potential borrowers, are a bit more cushioned from the effects of this policy tightening than others in other jurisdictions. The burdens imposed by the monetary policy shifts have not been passed on by the banking sector in terms of raising interest rates. So on the one hand, it is a very good position for a Maltese prospective homeowner that they will not be faced with rapidly rising interest rates in the banking sector, at least as things stand today. However, on the other hand, as we have been referring to, they are faced with rapidly increasing property prices. If you look at, for example, the last 10 years, the census, which was recently published by the NSO, property prices have increased roughly 20%. In a very short amount of time. That's not even the 10 years, that is a handful of years, a 20% increase in average property prices. So there is definitely work that can be done to improve the situation across the board when it comes to accessing the right affordable housing and providing that access equitably to the public. Now, taking a bit of a more focused perspective, my own experience at AP as a bank, as you referenced, we believe, and it's actually part of our vision and mission as a bank, to serve the community, to be involved in the social and economic development and prosperity of the communities we serve. So we believe in taking a proactive role where we work with a number of institutions, such as the Housing Authority, to actively assist, and we've actually been one of the founding partners, financial intermediary partners, on a number of the schemes, the home deposit scheme, the equity sharing scheme, both of these schemes were referenced earlier. So we believe that taking a proactive approach in order to understand the various needs of the entire market and really try and cater for those individuals who need that extra nudge, that extra push in order to acquire the right the property that is right for them. Now, when we're talking of improvements, yes, so even from year to year, there are many things that can be done to improve the access to schemes, the access to financial products that are available on the market.
So, sorry to interrupt, the schemes that you've been sort of partnering up with the Housing Authority on, what's the feedback you get? Have they been working well? Have they made the difference that we want them to make after all?
That's a very good question. So I think when considering the schemes specifically that we are involved in, one of our key KPIs, performance indicators that we use to evaluate the success, is the number of households, the number of people that we are able to help at the end of the day. That is the bottom line that we are there for, to help households have access to these types of properties. So as of today, we have almost helped over the last few years 500 households across both our main schemes, which are the home deposit scheme and the equity sharing scheme offered in partnership with the Housing Authority. So yes, we believe that the schemes are effective. These are people at the end of the day who, for one reason or another, depending on the nature of the scheme that they find themselves targeting, would not have been able to access the property market via more conventional, traditional channels, which is seeking a standard mortgage from a bank. So these schemes are definitely effective. Hundreds of households have been helped across the number of schemes available. Regarding improvements, as I was saying, there are always things we can improve. And again, we believe in being a proactive partner on these schemes. We regularly are in touch with Matthew and his team, providing our own feedback, listening to their feedback, and collaboratively working to try and see what we can improve. And even very recently, just under a month ago, I believe, we announced a number of revisions and improvements, enhancements to these underlying schemes, and renewed them for a further term. Again, trying to strengthen our commitment to the local market in terms of being able to provide them a range of possibilities so that every individual feels as though they are able to access an opportunity that is right for them.
Fantastic. No, certainly those numbers suggest that things are indeed working well, at least on that front. Up to this point, we've discussed affordable housing as something that we all desire, as something desirable. I think that would be true from the perspective of policymakers, the people who'd like to purchase a home and so on. But we haven't really touched upon why we need affordable housing. And Rachel, this is where I'd like to bring you into the discussion with this very simple, straightforward, but very important question, I believe. Why do we need affordable housing? Why does Malta need it?
Hi, first of all, thank you for the invitation. And of course, I'm sorry I can't be there with you, but thankfully we have technology that can assist us with this. Yes, why? It's a very, very important question. I think the first thing to start from is to understand society that we are living in. So how has society changed over the course of the years, especially since we joined the European Union? Because so much of the social fabric of the Maltese society, including the Maltese household, which has been actually at the center of most changes at a legislative level, but also at a policy level, right? So we must understand why affordable housing now, because we always had social housing. We're quite at an advantage stage in Malta, even when we compare ourselves to other European member states, that actually we have a very good system. Some like countries like Greece, Portugal don't even have social housing. So that's important to make it very clear that as a Maltese society, we're not doing too badly on this housing issue. However, I think there are three main points that are important to bring up into this very lively discussion on affordable housing. First and foremost, I believe that it's related to migratory patterns. Migratory patterns have shifted, especially since the economic boom, which Malta we can say it's been around since 2013. So that has attracted a lot of foreigners, obviously, because of work opportunities. And migratory patterns also spurred by wars and natural disasters, but also by persecution. For example, we're starting to see an increase in the LGBTIQ individuals coming to Malta because of persecution. And there's also a changing family configuration, which I think Jake made reference to. So the Maltese household has changed due to an increase in longevity. So people are living longer. So we have a lot of older people that are solo living, but also a lot of young people are choosing to live solo. We have also a lot of young families which are having fewer children. Okay, and they're also getting married much later. So we have this kind of composition also of divorced, blended families, which require further support. Before, we did have the family to come instead of the state. But nowadays, because of these social transformations, it's not as possible. We have a lot of intergenerational households as well, which harbor a lot of hidden homeless people. So more often than not, the parents of those who are divorced or living in blended families do not have the support that we used to have, say, 10 to 20 years ago. And the other point which I'd like to mention is an increase in population. The United Nations is predicting that by 2050, most people will be living in urbanized zones and localities, including cities. And Malta is definitely on the forefront of this shift. So it's important that, yes, now Malta starts to have its own sector of housing affordability, which is separate from the market. And I think this is the question where we need to, or what we need to reflect upon, because currently most of the work that we do, both as banks, housing authorities, these kind of schemes are serving the market more than the needs of society. So we need to have a strong, affordable housing sector that can thrive on its own.
Understand you well, the socio-economic context in which we're in is changing, and indeed it has changed a lot. You've mentioned population, demographics, and also, you know, the way the Maltese economy has been transformed over these past few years. They all change everything, you know, they change the playing field, so to say. Potentially, I'll come back to you, Rachel, but potentially, Miguel, you must see these changes in the home loan applications, right, that you get as a bank. Would you care to sort of tell us what sort of difference you see, perhaps when you compare to the sort of applications that you would have seen a few years ago?
Of course, yes. And I think this is a particularly interesting question. So part of my role and that of my colleagues, of course, at the bank is evaluating and researching the market. We use a lot of data, published reporting, whether it's national statistics, reports from the central bank, for example, or even reports from other participants within the private sector, other industry players. And what we see when you really evaluate the data is that there has been a dramatic shift in recent years in terms of a rapid pace of evolution of the market, of what's available, of what is happening. So think of it, let's take a bit of a broader picture at first, a 30-year span, which is something most people can relate to because perhaps it makes up the majority of our lives. There was a huge shift in the housing stock over the last 30 years. But when you actually look into the data, you realize that the majority of that shift has been over the last 10-year period, from, let's say, 2011 to 2021. In that period, you see our housing stock increase by 33%, up to a figure of roughly 300K today, in terms of individual dwellings, housing units. Now, that increase alone might sound like a lot, but then if you dig even further, you realize that the composition of this market is shifting as well. For example, the recent census data shows that this is the first time ever in our history that apartments have taken over as the leading development, the leading type of dwelling being developed in Malta. The number of apartments makes up almost 50% of our housing stock today, whereas in the past, it was a minority. Now, the next largest type after apartments would be maisonettes, but that makes up half the amount of apartments. So really, there has been a dramatic shift in terms of the availability and the quality, as Jake was referring to earlier, of housing units that is available. Putting that growth, that significant growth, into terms we can understand, so on a yearly basis, it's roughly increasing by 7,000 units, 7,000 dwellings, which is about 20 dwellings every day. New dwellings coming onto the market, increasing Malta's housing stock. And as we've just heard as well, as the statistics showed us, the majority would be apartments. So really what we see today, that we haven't seen in the past, is that people are finding it increasingly difficult to achieve the balance, as we referred to earlier, as my colleagues referred to earlier, around finding a property that is right for them, perhaps in an area that is adequate for them, maybe not ideal, but adequate. So there would be some need to give and take when it comes to what you're able to afford and what you can look for within your price range. Whereas in the past, this would have been a lot easier because prices were lower, the stock was of a higher quality in general, let's say, than what we see today. So we're really seeing an evolution of the market itself, the underlying stock of dwellings that is available, and therefore that has translated into a shift in a response from our retail borrowers, the types of properties they're looking for. Added to this as well, we have to understand that the segmentation, the demographics of the population has also shifted. So in the last 10 years, the foreign workforce, expatriates, has grown by about 5 times from what it was just, 10, 11 years ago. It now makes up 20% of our overall population. So these are people, of course, who need access to adequate and affordable housing, whether it's through the rental market, which tends to be the majority, or even those longer term, with longer term prospects on the island, who are looking to buy their own home. So it really is a new dynamic, I think, in the market today. That is not quite what we have seen in the past. Rising prices, a difference in terms of the quality and availability of housing stock, and also consumer mentality is slightly shifting.
Right. So indeed, a lot has been changing. Gracie earlier mentioned, demographics. You mentioned that as well. But in addition to that, the market too has changed in a very dramatic way, perhaps in response to these social demographic changes. And that sort of sets me thinking on a point made by Rachel a little bit earlier, that perhaps the way in which we deal with affordable housing issues in the future might have to change as well. We might have to adjust in that way as well. I think Matthew alluded to that earlier as well. Jake, the Foundation for Affordable Housing is, as you said, a relatively new player. So very much, its actions are going to be pretty much in the future of the housing market. What are the solutions that you guys are thinking about?
So I think this is the most pertinent question because the conference bears this name, right? And as an organization, we were set up to come up with innovative solutions to provide that in-between class with affordable solutions, with adequate housing solutions. But let me start from the level of principle, if I may. We believe it stands to reason that if you are in work and earning a stable regular income, you should be able to afford a decent home, whether you want to buy or you want to rent. We believe it stands to reason that with greater development should come greater opportunities for everyone to find a decent housing arrangement. Now, if that's not happening, then there is a systemic issue somewhere. And systemic issues are only addressed with systemic changes. Now, when it comes to systemic changes, we are active on a wide panorama of activities. First of all, we're engaging the market. We are open to collaborate with any member of the private sector keen on bolstering their ESG portfolio, especially that S component inside ESG. Secondly, and this is also a matter of principle to us, we believe that market-level developments should be paying for, or at least enable, affordable housing solutions. Market-level developments should be paying for, or at least enable, affordable housing solutions. And this isn't such a radical idea. A lot of Western developed economies have this embedded in their urban policy in some form or another. Because with greater development should come greater opportunities for everyone to find a decent housing arrangement. And we believe in this so much that it lies at the very basis of our first major initiative, on which we will provide ample information in the days to come. Thirdly, there is the planning policy. Malta changed, the housing needs changed, the demand became even more heterogeneous than it was, and we still produce the same kind of supply we used to provide in the early noughties, in the early 2000s. We are very keen on introducing new concepts, new housing models to the planning policy, to the current planning policy, with the hope of diversifying the currently rigid supply, in my opinion, which is reminiscent of the Malta and the people we used to be. Fourthly, finally, we are seeking to provide different financing terms, to provide newer investment alternatives, to widen, to open the property market to an even larger group of people, to not leave it a party of the few, okay? Restricted to a few.
So essentially, you know, some ambitious targets there, but also some of them, if I understood you well, we should expect to learn more about them in the immediate future.
I admit there are very ambitious targets there in what I've mentioned. However, there are very doable set of key points which we have embarked on, and we are nearing very important results as well.
We look forward to seeing them materialize very soon. The discussion sort of right now has come to a point where we're discussing, you know, things that have been reshaping the Malta we're used to living in. And, you know, part of what the bank's been experiencing, what the foundation is hoping to do, seeks to fit within this future for Maltese housing. Matthew, the housing authority is, of course, at the very heart of all that will be happening. What is your vision for the housing market?
Our vision is clear. Our vision is that to ensure that every family in Malta can afford a house of their own. Now, as we've discussed throughout this discussion, it's imperative to understand and lay foundations of what our understanding is of affordable housing, quality housing, and as Jake and Rachel explained earlier, we need to be aware of the current situation and that we're embracing currently, of the influx of foreigners, the new profiles coming in the mix that we're currently facing. And we need to couple that with a new understanding of housing. Okay? Housing within communities. So it's not just a question of the tenement itself, the household itself, but the community where that household is currently placed. My take on this is that, first of all, I would like to thank MSF for the opportunity to discuss housing in Malta very few years ago. I remember a time four or five years ago where we were not even discussing housing in Malta. Nowadays, these kind of forums give opportunity for all to discuss these kind of ideas and grasping a better understanding of what the current market is providing and where we're heading. And I would like to extend an invitation to the general public and an invitation to all interested parties to join in the discussion, to contact us as Housing Authority, to leverage this opportunity okay, and growth of opportunities. We are would like to thank also APS for their ongoing support within our schemes and the newly formed Affordable Housing Foundation. We are in constant discussion and always analyzing data and what is happening for us to ensure that we provide what our vision is for the future, to ensure that each and every family can afford a house of their own. And I would like to close off with that, an invitation to the general public and those all attending this conference to join in the discussion, pitch in their ideas, and to ensure adequate and affordable housing for all.
That sounds very promising in terms of, you know, trying to help plan for the future together on the housing market. So I'm sure that will be an invitation that will be welcomed by many following us. One of the the members of our audience has actually picked on a point that you've mentioned about quality, the quality of housing. And so the idea is that, okay, if we have to, in a way, compromise the quality of housing to make it affordable, then obviously we're going to lose a lot, right? So potentially one of the things to think about going forward is how to actually ensure that the quality of the of housing that is affordable is actually available there.
Precisely my point previously. I tend to disagree that we need to limit our understanding and degrade our understanding of quality housing. What we can explore, and that is what we're exploring even with the foundation, is new form of households where you can have smaller spaces but bigger spaces where there are shared opportunities. Like where families can enjoy free time, access to public gardens, access to daily needs, and that is also a pertinent issue. One of more forms of discussion to explain it in better terms in a practical example is that we encounter situations of elderly people that are living in big homes and would like to trade those same big homes with smaller units, but which are more accessible, but they would like to ensure that they remain within the same community. So it's like a question of balancing the need of staying within that same community and trading off the size of the unit, of the dwelling itself. And that is becomes, as we grow old, it becomes more important that we remain in our communities and we remain within quality housing. And quality housing is not necessarily big households, but quality housing means that we are able to sustain what we require in our lives and for our families, and making adjustments as required. One of our projects that we embarked upon over the past 2 years is that we have an intergenerational concept. In Europe, it's run-of-the-mill sometimes in certain countries, but in Malta it's a first, where we traded elderly people homes, which were big dwellings, into smaller units, but into a concept of intergenerational, where we have a number of units being shared by elderly and young individuals, single households. And it is very, 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 very nice to see.
This has happened already?
This has happened already.
Right, because I was going to say, if we can find ways of doing it, that would be a very sensible thing.
It's a pilot project, obviously not without its issues itself, but we have embarked upon it, and it's working. And it's nice, this week I had the opportunity to visit the premises itself, and you listen to those elderly people that say, listen, this is working. We had the young individuals helping us in our daily errands or some of their daily needs, supporting them, buying their necessary stuff, and supporting them in their daily lives. And it is a very nice concept to see. We are looking forward towards, that is why I had invited the general public and any partners, both public, private, and individuals, to join in and supply and sustain any kind of initiatives or ideas of this type to take these new forms of tenements, these new forms of housing, and help us to redefine what we understand with housing and quality housing. Hope I answered.
Indeed, I think that's small steps in the right direction. I would imagine. Before moving on to Rachel, there's another question from the audience that I'd like you, Jake, to address. Even Matthew earlier mentioned that there are efforts with the Foundation for Affordable Housing, with the banks and so on. So it seems that there is, you know, a group of institutions, players working together. But it is not always clear what you guys are doing differently from what the Housing Authority is actually targeting. Now, if you can elaborate a little bit more on that point.
Okay. First of all, the distinction lies in the nature, in our nature. One is part and parcel of the government, and the other is really and truly an independent institution operating on the open market.
So is it the case that the Housing Authority is, in a sense, representing the state, whereas the Foundation for Affordable Housing is actually a market player that is more socially driven, so to say?
You have the Housing Authority. I wouldn't like to speak for other people, but the Housing Authority, as part of government, has its own ways of using government budget in the best possible manner, right, to fulfill public policy. Mm-hmm. And of course, it provides social accommodation, it supports affordable accommodation. Up until a few months ago, it was the only organization in Malta, okay, focused on supporting affordable housing schemes. There was no other organization doing this job. Now, there is the Foundation for Affordable Housing. It is a social enterprise. There is, of course, the involvement of the government, as it is one of the partners founding this organization. However, we are different by nature, right? Yeah,
and if I understood you well earlier, it's also the case that the group of people that you're targeting might be different. You're targeting more
we
those...
We might be complementing each other when it comes to the in-between class, because the Housing Authority did not remain stuck because there was no other organization focused on affordable housing in Malta. The government couldn't remain stuck to simply providing social accommodation. So it had to take the initiative and focus on the in-between class. Now there are us, this new organization completely focused on this in-between class, the stretched class, those people who aren't welfare dependents but who aren't earning enough to be able to venture into the open market unaided. And we'll use our own mechanisms, our own ways within market dynamics, okay? We'll use our own funds, basically. We'll source funds from the private market in order to provide different alternative solutions.
I think that clarifies.
I hope it was very
thank clear. You. Thank you very much. I'd like to close off this discussion on a point that I've picked earlier from Rachel's intervention. Rachel, earlier you alluded to the idea that if we're thinking about the future, about adjusting to the socio-demographic changes, to how the market has changed and so on, we might have to think of an alternative to this schemes-based approach that we currently, you know, that currently sort of serves the market. Can you elaborate on that point, please?
I think this is a very important way forward for the future, right? Because it's important to now move from a very reactive kind of position where we are reacting to an increase in population, an increase in demand, a change at a family household level. Now it's time, we have the indicators, we have the data, so we need to look forward. And my advice would be to be looking at a system-based approach, right, which has certain principles at heart, which sustainability is, of course, one of them. Affordability is another, but also issues which are related to inclusivity, issues which are related to access to housing, who has access to affordable housing, but what does affordable housing also mean, right? It's not just about the rent. It's not just about the economy. And up until now, the conversation stayed very much at the level of housing. But what we really need to think about for the future is our homes, right? Our homes, you know, are not just a mathematical formula, which economists tend to tell us is the most valid type of narrative, but we also need to look at the social value of our homes. So how can this affordable sector of new type of housing, which will also need to include a different kind of design, right? Design is extremely important because of the way family compositions and individuals are living as well. And design is very political. There's an intent behind it. And it is one way of how we can reach to people with this long-term vision, which takes a socially aware design. It does not leave anyone behind, but it's also, let's remember that our homes are the glue of society. Without a healthy sector of homes, then we cannot have a healthy nation. So the two go pretty much hand in hand. And let's remember that our homes, even housing, is not solely about giving, you know, a roof over one's head, but it's also about community building. And I see that Matthew, very happy that Matthew made reference to that. So if our homes are not properly connected to, you know, open green spaces, safe pathways, security systems, a properly mixed and matched society, right? Then we cannot truly allow people to flourish, because ultimately having your own home and sense of security is about prosperity. But in that type of prosperity, we really must, and I always make this call, to include the social dimension, to include the social value alongside the economic value of our home. So in the future, yes, I would want to say that our homes are, you know, put in each and every policy. So we don't only talk to planning, if we do, but we must, but to the health ministries, to the inclusion ministries, to all the government entities to come on board to ensure that we have a holistic and system-based approach to our homes. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Rachel. I think you've sort of closed this discussion on a very, very nice point. I want to thank all the panelists. It's a pity that time has run out already. Thank you all the panelists for sharing your view on this topic, and also the audience for sending their questions. Any questions which we didn't manage to answer and include in the discussion, we'll be happy to answer them after the event. And I'm told that they will be actually uploaded on the MSF's website. The objective of the Malta Sustainability Forum is to raise awareness and empower citizens to make conscious decisions towards a more sustainable life. So our final presentation will be delivered by Ms. Shamay Mandjon, the chairman of the Housing Development Fund, who will be sharing practical insights for future sustainable actions.
Good evening. I'm pleased to welcome you to our presentation on future sustainable actions in affordable housing solutions. As the chairperson of the Housing Development Fund, I'll be sharing insights into innovative strategies that promise a more sustainable future for affordable housing. Today, our focus extends beyond bricks and mortar. We're on a journey to explore future sustainable actions in affordable housing solutions, with an emphasis on inclusivity, with delve into innovative strategies that not only transform individual lives, but also uplift entire communities. In the insightful words of Melinda Gates, a decent home is the foundation for a successful life, and it is the fulcrum upon which our lives balance. And this perspective aligns seamlessly with Maslow's hierarchy of needs, where shelter serves as the fundamental base, providing safety and security essential for our overall well-being. Today, as we delve into future sustainable housing solutions, let's reflect on the profound influence a stable home environment has on shaping lives. In simple terms, it's about making homes that benefit everyone, and explore these homes provide stability, education, health, and togetherness. It's not just about buildings, it's about moving towards to create better quality of lives, even in the face of challenges. Here, we cannot now not shift our focus to three pivotal aspects, which are CSR, Sustainable Development Goals, and social housing. Now, let's focus on CSR. In the modern corporate landscape, businesses are recognizing the imperative to give back. CSR initiatives extend their reach beyond boardrooms, investing in projects that in some way link to affordable housing. Through CSR, companies actively participate in uplifting the quality of our communities, which contributes to their successes and society, aligning profit with purpose. Yet we must recognize a pivotal truth that to accelerate these transformative initiatives, businesses need support, and we must make it easier for them to invest in CSR through better incentives, awareness, and recognition. Now, when it comes to SDGs, the UNs provide a universal blueprint for a sustainable future. In fact, if we focus on Goal 11, it talks about sustainable cities and communities, which resonates deeply with our housing discourse. By integrating housing initiatives with SDGs, we bridge local efforts with global ambitions. Through a collaborative approach where local actions ripple globally, contributing to a more sustainable world. Social housing. Social housing is the core of our discussion. The concept of social housing is viewed as a basic human right rather than a commodity. Social housing policies bridge socioeconomic disparities, ensuring that everyone, regardless of their financial standing, has access to housing, with an approach that to transform the idea of a home from a privilege to a fundamental right. Understanding how CSR, SDGs, and social housing intersect is pivotal. Businesses embracing CSR align their initiatives with global objectives for a greater impact, while social housing policies rooted in social justice directly contribute to the achieving multiple SDGs, creating resilient and inclusive communities. The holistic quality and well-being, and here I'll switch to this slide. This is an extract from Times of Malta, which was recently obtained. It shows that we have transferred the idea that our homes look like, from, of course, large houses with gardens and spacious living areas, family members next door. We went to smaller apartments, reflecting maybe a more practical solution to the modern but busy lifestyle. Ensuring holistic quality and well-being in affordable housing now means optimizing smaller spaces, integrating amenities with communities, and fostering social connections despite limited square footage. This shift demands innovative design and community planning to maintain a high standard of living in a more compact environment, which ultimately poses a challenge in affordable housing initiatives. So as we recognize the changing landscape of housing, ensuring holistic quality of life is pivotal. Let's look into an alternative and innovative solution. So for instance, we don't have that backyard, so a shared open social space is crucial. By maximizing the utilization of open and shared spaces, one of which can be designed communal areas within apartments, complexes, fostering a sense of community and social interaction. These spaces can be gardens, playgrounds, foyer, or recreational areas. But not only, open public spaces in front of our dwellings are to be embellished to take place of that traditional backyard. Another instance would be that common roofs are transferred into roof gardens, offering residential recreational spaces among urban living. These initiatives not only maximize the utility of availability and the areas that we have, but also create serene spaces where families can unwind, fostering healthier recreational approaches, which are also practical for a busy lifestyle. Now, as affordable priced home solutions, we can look into subsidies and incentives to reduce the financial burden for low-income families, making home ownership more available. Private-public partnerships, collaborations between private developers and government bodies can lead to innovative, cost-effective housing projects, increasing the supply of affordable homes. Community land trust, establishing community land trust preserves lands for affordable housing, preventing speculative real estate practices and ensuring long-term affordability. Financial literacy and assistance, providing financial literacy programs and support services empowers individuals to make informed decisions, guiding them towards sustainable home ownership. Sustainable energy and efficiency is also a solution here by integrating eco-friendly technologies, ensuring long-term affordability. Community engagement, involving local communities and organizations in the planning and decision-making purposes, ensures that housing initiatives are tailored to specific needs, fostering a sense of ownership and pride. Now, as for housing for vulnerable groups, we need to ensure dignified living for vulnerable groups demands targeting solutions which are tailor-made. Here are initiatives designed to enhance social housing and cater to specific needs, like social housing specialized projects. These tailored housing projects caters to the unique needs of vulnerable communities, providing safe and supportive environments with necessary designs, amenities, and services that provide a tailor-made solution and addresses the significant challenges directly. There are sensory schemes. By creating sensory friendly areas within their living spaces designed for individuals with sensory processing challenges, fostering comfort and ease in daily living. Accessibility schemes, implementing accessible principles, ensuring that housing units are accessible to all, including those with mobility that needs further facilitation. Intergenerational housing promotes an intergenerational approach, of course, so different age groups coexist in the same block or complex. Fostering mutual support and understanding among generations to bridge existing gaps. This innovative approach not only addresses housing challenges, but also enriches communities by encouraging diverse interactions and shared experiences. Care plans, by implementing comprehensive care plans within housing complexes, offering medical, psychological, and social support, ensures residents' well-being in a tailored manner solution. Specialized schemes, developing housing schemes tailored for vulnerable groups, such as mentioned, the elderly, single-parent families, domestic violence survivors, or individuals with disabilities, amongst others. By addressing these, we are targeting unique requirements. These initiatives reflect a commitment to creating not just shelters, but nurturing an environment where everyone, regardless of their challenges, can lead a fulfilling life. the economic and environmental impact. What are the solutions there? Optimizing the affordable housing fund and implementing innovative strategies are key to ensuring accessible, sustainable living. Here are targeted solutions for enhancing this affordable living. So with this fund, we can allocate resources which are focused on holistic development, including infrastructure, green spaces, therapy, extracurriculum opportunities, and other communal facilities to improve an overall living standards within affordable housing projects. The tax incentive when it comes to CSR, where projects are encouraged by businesses through tax incentives to invest in community-focused projects, enhancing the social fabric of affordable housing complexes and empowering residents. Energy efficiency, once again, implementing energy efficiency technologies and practices, reducing utility costs and promoting sustainable living within affordable housing units, thereby making them more economical for residents. Passive designs integrate passive design principles that maximize, for instance, natural lights, ventilation, insulation, ensuring comfortable living conditions while minimizing energy consumption and costs. Education is always key, so educational workshops on green practices to promote green practices among residents, fostering a community-wide commitment to environmental sustainability. And lastly, the near to zero housing solutions and embracing cutting-edge technologies and construction methods to create near zero energy homes, which will significantly reduce the environment impact and operational costs for residents. By adopting these solutions, we transform affordable housing into thriving eco-conscious communities, regardless of the income, which one can benefit from a sustainable, high-quality living. I thank you all for your time and attention towards working together to a sustainable and more affordable housing. Should you have any innovative ideas or projects or other interests, please feel free to get in touch on the email shown on your screens, and we'll be happy to collaborate with. Thank you very much, and once again, have a nice evening.
We have come to an end of our agenda for today. I would like to introduce, invite Ms. Liana De Battista, Chief Strategy Officer of APS Bank, for her concluding remarks.
Good evening. For today's MSF, we delved into the topic of affordable housing. We hear so much on social media, TV programs, and the news about what is happening around us, for instance, to a particular family or an individual. But for the average person in the street, one who lives comfortably, going about their everyday life, the reality could not be further from that experienced by those who are less fortunate. It is a reality where one might not be able to grasp just how pressing the topic of affordable housing has become. The Malta Sustainability Forum is intended as a platform to share information and raise awareness, often on complex issues, like today, in a way it can be understood by the general public. We strive to create the time and space for dialogue and engaging conversations about the underlying issues, complexities, and realities that so many families are facing. But how do we sum up the topic of today? What is affordable housing, and what is being done by the different stakeholders, both locally and on an international level? As we heard today, it means a lot of different things to different people. Technically, a house, a dwelling, is deemed to be affordable when a family is spending less than 30% of their income on that housing as their primary residence. A point also mentioned by Dr. Brian McAuliffe. So anytime a family is forced to spend 30% or more of their income on housing, that is when housing is deemed to be not affordable for the family. And this applies whether it's a family unit or an individual, whether the residence is owned or rented out, It can be temporary, it can be permanent, but it is that 30% that defines whether the housing is affordable or not. As a banker, I can vouch that banks are very much aware of this, and a responsible banker carefully considers these parameters when looking at financing properties. It would be extremely responsible of us if we were to disregard these estimates. On the other hand, if a family is spending more than 30% of their income on housing, then it is deemed to be cost burden. This means the cost of housing for this family reduces their ability to purchase everyday necessities. Being severely cost burdened takes things one step further, and that's when a family is spending more than 50% of their income on housing. When you hear about individuals who are spending around half of their salary on rent alone, these people are considered severely cost burdened, and their quality of life is heavily impacted for the worse. It becomes extremely difficult for them to navigate, to get by, to be able to cover normal expenses. That's when trade-offs come into play. We have heard of people being forced to work two or three jobs concurrently just to be able to have enough money left over for food and transport. Sometimes the trade-off means living in a small, overcrowded apartment. We are seeing families forcing themselves to adapt to substandard conditions just to ensure they have a roof over their heads. It is heartbreaking to witness this injustice on so many families and individuals in our society. In a way, they are sacrificing what so many of us take for granted. Charmaine Manjon mentioned a few of these challenges, which include having basic needs such as safety, security, and sanitation. Not so long ago, I overheard a conversation in which a woman was explaining to a friend of hers that she could not afford to buy medicine for a common cold. These are the most vulnerable amongst us. They are people who can't afford to get sick, since most of their income is already committed to living expenses, let alone saving for a rainy day, or having disposable income to be able to have some fun, or invest in themselves by pursuing further education, for example. How visible are these struggles? How often do we stop and consider how many people experience these challenges on a daily basis? These can easily be your neighbors, your colleagues, people in the community. What's so shocking is that it can be hidden so well. The good news is that we also heard how different entities, whether it's the European Commission, government, agencies, NGOs, financial institutions, are coming together to mitigate and rectify the situation, with a focus on stability and affordable homeownership in particular. This will help people to transition and become homeowners to have an affordable place to call home. There are various schemes and programs that are accessible to these individuals and which have high success rates. Still, we can all agree that there is a long way to go. Next time you get home from an exhausting day and you might find yourself saying, "Home sweet home," take a moment to reflect about what we have discussed here today and how you can help in this situation. If you have the ability to get involved in one of the organizations that are working on affordable housing, that are doing great work in the community, there is always a need for resources, whether it's talent, time, or even getting involved in the decisions that are actually made in relation to this topic. We can all be advocates. If you hear something, say something. We must all make the effort to be aware of what is happening around us and understand and care about our friends and neighbors. Although it is the end of the event today, it's not the end of the dialogue. The MSF is an ongoing communication channel and other discussions will be held over the coming months. I hope to see you soon and thank you for listening.
And with Ms. De Battista's closing comments, we come to an end to today's Malta Sustainability Forum on Affordable Housing Solutions. We hope that you have enjoyed following the event as much as we have delivering it to you.
We will be sending you a short feedback form. This will help us understand your needs and your interest rates to help us prepare for future events. A recording of today's forum will be available on MSF's website as of next week. And you can be the first to know about future events by following the Malta Sustainability Forum on social media. Thank you once again for joining the conversation to sustain tomorrow today. And we look forward to seeing you to our next events as we learn, engage and act with the Malta Sustainability Forum.